Welcome, audience, climate mobilization members. We're really glad to have you here to learn about what we think is a very exciting way to solve the climate crisis. One continual problem in the climate movement is how do we approach this topic? How do we approach this crisis that is so huge? It's global, it's extinction level, we're talking about the collapse of civilization, it's our entire energy system. So how do we approach this immensity? What do we do with it? And too often, the climate movement settles for small bore solutions or fights. And the climate mobilization says, no, we need a sweeping changes on a national and international level. And rather than saying, well, it's not possible, so let's not go there, we say we will accomplish what is necessary. So we start from the presumptions that we are in an acute climate crisis, a global emergency, that climate change threatens to cause the collapse of civilization within this century, possibly sooner than that, and that within the climate movement and people who write about climate change, there really is a hidden consensus about the need for World War II scale mobilization. It's very strange when you start to research climate change and what people say about it to see how incredibly often a World War II scale mobilization comes up. It is a time in our history that we completely transitioned our economy to face an existential threat very rapidly. So we are a group that says, let's not just talk about this idea of a World War II scale climate mobilization, let's make it happen. So, okay, that sounds good, but how? Our tool is the Pledge to Mobilize. The Pledge to Mobilize is a one-page document that any American can sign, and we're going international, so actually at this point any person on the planet can sign it. The Pledge to Mobilize is a political platform and a social movement strategy in one. Signers demand that the government coordinates a World War II scale mobilization to fight climate change and save civilization, but these are not idle words. Signers pledge to vote for candidates who have signed the pledge over those who have not, devote time, money, or both to elected officials and political candidates who have signed this pledge too. And third, perhaps most importantly, mobilize my skills, resources, and networks to spread the truth of climate change and the hope of this movement to others. So these are political and personal demands, but they're all within the context of building a national movement, a national solution. So as opposed to what the climate movement or climate education can get too into, right? You make a change your lifestyle, right? Drive less, something, you know, turn off your lights. We provide a route to engagement that connects the hyper-local, right? Talk to your neighbors, your friends, your family, your congregation, your book group, with the national and international. So let's talk about the first mobilization. Let's talk about World War II and what happened, because I think most people know, you know, we won the war, but it's much less known how incredibly far behind we were at the beginning of the war and how much denial there was in the country about the danger at all. The United States had just gotten out of World War I, kind of a bloody fiasco, and the mood was isolationist, right? We said, we don't want to arm ourselves, we don't want to be involved in foreign conflicts, we're fine, it's a European thing, we're gonna stay out of it. So because of that, in 1940, the Axis powers held the advantage, and a huge advantage, in tanks, planes, guns, military spending, military size, military production and strategy. The Germans, after World War I, rebuilt their entire armament production system in a huge way, and they pioneered a new form of warfare called the Blitzkrieg, in which you combine air, ground, and sea assault at the same time, and it was incredibly effective. They were sweeping through Europe, while in the United States, this is one of my favorite factoids, there was still, the common knowledge in the United States Army that horses were more powerful than tanks because they didn't have to refuel. So you could cut your supply lines. So in the United States, we were just not with the program that that mechanized warfare was more effective. So we were way behind. But following Pearl Harbor, which like a waking up from a dream, we realized the danger we were in, and we declared war with unanimous but for one vote, and we mobilized for total victory, meaning war production skyrocketed. And how did this happen? I mean, it didn't just skyrocket on its own. Federal spending skyrocketed, the government invested in military production, there were strong regulations on consumption, production, and the consumer economy was scaled way back. Okay, so during World War II, home front mobilization in the United States, gas was rationed, tires were rationed, meat was rationed, sugar was rationed, razor blades. There was, for a couple of years, there were no production of new automobiles whatsoever because all of the automobile factories were producing tanks and planes. There was all hands on deck, huge participation. This is not like the wars we have today where you have an army that comes from a small segment of the population that the rest of the country basically ignores the engagement. This was the entire country supporting the war effort in ways that affected every part of life. Your job, people moved across the country, 10% of Americans moved across the country to find a war job. Many women went into work in the war production who had never worked in a factory or anywhere outside of the home before. And then there was also participation at the home level. 40% of vegetables consumed during World War II were grown at home in victory gardens. There were huge scrap drives. It is really hard to overstate the degree to which the World War II home front mobilization transformed life in this country in order to win the war, for the shared goal of winning the war. So what were the impacts, right? Well, obviously we won the war. This mobilization helped to usher in the largest economic boom in history. We achieved full employment during the home front mobilization. And there were huge gains in equality between races, between men and women, because when you have a shared national project that is more important than anything else, then you say, well, I guess we're gonna have to have a more equal system because we need everyone. And there were technological breakthroughs in every field. Most well known is the Manhattan Project, which is, while dubious in outcome, you know, we created the most powerful weapon the world had ever seen. It is unquestionably tremendous scientifically, right? It was a huge breakthrough. But there was also the first blood transfusion happened during World War II. Huge, huge advances in medicine, treating infections. Code breaking, the first real computer Alan Turing invented during the war. I mean, it's really every field, huge breakthroughs. So now we come to climate. This is Lonnie Thompson, who with a striking quote, he says, climatologists, like other scientists, tend to be a stolid group. We are not given to theatrical rantings about falling skies. Why then are climatologists speaking about the dangers of global warming? The answer is virtually all of us are now convinced that global warming poses a clear and present danger to civilization. Let's put that in context. First I'll say it's kind of amazing to me how not surprising this is to many people. I talk about it all the time to people, the bank teller who, you know, I'm calling about the climate mobilization, or someone on the street, and I say, oh, you know, the climate mobilization wants to prevent the collapse of civilization from climate change. And people say, oh, right, mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's like becoming common knowledge. I mean, some people, sure, are surprised, but I'm more surprised by the amount of people who know this, who know that we are teetering on the edge of collapse. So climate change basics, perhaps this is review, if so, pardon me, but greenhouse gases trap solar radiation, so, you know, our heat comes in from the sun, and then much of it goes back into space, and greenhouse gases act like a blanket around the atmosphere, keeping more of that energy in. This is a basic scientific fact that we've known about since the 1800s, that CO2 is a greenhouse gas. It traps heat and energy in the atmosphere. I mean, that's why temperatures are going up. That's why we see ice melt in the Arctic, in every glacial system in the world. In a sense, more complicated to understand is not why carbon and greenhouse gases trap heat, but just the incredible amount of impacts that it has on the planet that heat is trapped, right? So, some of them are listed here. We are seeing tropical diseases move north, species dying off because their ecosystems are changing because of these heat changes. Dangerous heat waves, like in India right now, people just dying from overheating. Ice sheet collapse and sea level rise, both because of ice collapse, but also because of water expands as it gets warmer. I'll actually take a note on that and say, I'm not an expert in climate change science. I'm not a scientist at all. I'm a clinical psychologist. And the scientific effects of climate change are so cascading that it would take an expert in virtually in so many fields to really be able to explain quite what's happening in the world. And this can be a barrier to entry for people. It was for me. To say, how can I talk about climate change? Because someone's gonna say, you know, what about sunspots? I read this study, you know, raise some kind of objection. And how do you respond? So I believe that we as lay people can and must make this issue our own. Warmer air causes more evaporation and is changing the kind of hydraulic cycles of the planet. So that's why we're seeing floods in Houston, droughts in California and Sao Paulo, and just severe weather all over the place, which then lead to widespread crop failures, more intense storms and damaged infrastructure, and displaced people, both nationally and internationally. And because we live in a completely fossil fuel-based economy, today, everything we do, basically, including this presentation, being here in this building with the lights and everything we do causes greenhouse gas emissions. We've warmed 0.85 degrees Celsius so far since the Industrial Revolution, which is important to keep in mind when you think about how extreme the changes are already. And when we talk about 2 degrees Celsius as the safe limit, when obviously now we're experiencing dangerous climate change. Even at 0.85 degrees Celsius, this is killing 400,000 people every year. The Pentagon knows that it's a threat. The Pentagon says it poses immediate risks and talks about climate change as a threat multiplier, exacerbating existing security problems. There are also tipping points. I talked about droughts and, of course, state failure, right? The scientific and climatic effects, you know, bump into our social systems, causing breakdown. So in Syria, for example, you had the largest drought in their history, a huge amount of farmers moving into cities because they could no longer support themselves on their farms. Food prices went way up. And you have a civil war. I mean, hungry and thirsty people don't just tend to sit around. Things get really unstable very quickly. So this is why Kevin Anderson said, a climate scientist said, a 4 degrees Celsius future is incompatible with an organized global community. It is likely to be beyond adaptation. It's devastating to the majority of ecosystems and has a high probability of not being stable. So we are on basically the worst case scenario for emissions trajectory, you know, starting since we have been talking about climate change for 2 decades and looking at different ways that our emissions could go. They have continually gone up, and the UK Met Office says that we could hit 4 degrees, which is not compatible with organized human civilization, by 2060. How old will you be? James Hansen, former NASA scientist, says planet Earth creation, the world in which civilization developed, the world with climate patterns that we know and stable shorelines, is in imminent peril. The urgency of the situation crystallized only in the past few years. The startling conclusion is that continued exploitation of all fossil fuels on Earth threatens not only the other millions of species on the planet, but also the survival of humanity itself. And the timetable is shorter than we thought. So climate change is an acute global crisis. The stakes have never been higher. That's why so many leading analysts have called for a whole society all-out climate mobilization. Now, this is where we get into the hidden consensus stuff, because what's amazing is the climate mobilization, not really too controversial an idea. In 2011, Tom Weiss delivered an open letter to President Obama and Hu Jintao calling for 80% reductions in US and China's carbon emissions by 2020 through a wartime-like mobilization. This was signed by the executive directors of basically every major environmental group, including Bill McKibben, Michael Brune, the director of Sierra Club, and the director of the other groups you see on the page. Here are the prominent writers, thinkers, and personalities who have endorsed a wartime scale climate mobilization. The president of the AFL-CIO, Ted Turner, the media mogul, New York Times columnist Thomas Friedman, Al Gore. I mean, this is not a fringe idea. So, the pledge to mobilize. A one-page document any American can sign. A tool to fight denial and create, usher in this climate mobilization that is so widely recognized as necessary. When you sign it, you call on the United States to, one, immediately commence a social and economic mobilization to restore a climate that is safe, stable, and supportive of human civilization. This heroic campaign shall be carried out on the scale of the American World War II home front mobilization and will require hard work and shared sacrifice from all Americans. Two, to reduce our country's net greenhouse gas emissions 100% by 2025 and implement far-reaching measures to remove greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. This is the most ambitious timetable that we've seen. That is precisely the point. If we could do it sooner, faster than this, we would want it faster than this. But this is we chose this timetable based on a political reality, which is in 2016, we'll be electing a new president and much of a new Congress. They can have 1 8-year administration to lead us through this mobilization, get us to net zero. In many ways, this is more realistic than the idea that we can reach zero by 2050 by administration after administration, working cooperatively and completing the goals set by the last person. We say, let's give it everything we've got. Like in World War II, we'll accomplish more than we ever thought possible. Enlist tens of millions of Americans in efforts to rapidly expand our carbon neutral energy and agricultural systems, conduct groundbreaking research, and implement large scale adaptation measures. As in World War II, full employment will be achieved. Conduct this mobilization in accordance with the Constitution and ensure that the essential needs of the civilian economy are met during this time of transition. And establish the following imperatives as our nation's top foreign policy priorities. A 100% reduction of global net greenhouse gas emissions at wartime speed and the deployment of comprehensive measures that remove greenhouse gases from the atmosphere until a safe climate is restored. Signers demand that the government coordinate a World War II scale mobilization to fight climate change and save civilization. These are not idle words, because as I went over, signers pledged to support candidates who have signed the pledge on every level, local, state, national, over those who have not, and to spread this pledge to others. And I gotta tell you, we launched in September at the People's Climate March, so we're about 9 months old, and it's very exciting progress. Our most recent, big name signatories are Ralph Nader signed the pledge about 10 days ago, and Marshall Saunders, the founder of Citizens Climate Lobby, signed the pledge yesterday. We have about 1,100 or 1,200 signers across the United States, including a lot of Unitarian clergy who are kind of expanding our efforts through their congregations. Just a little update. What the mobilization itself, I'm going to go through pretty briefly. How can we achieve these goals? Now, of course, that was the same question President Roosevelt got when he announced his extremely ambitious targets for armament. So we are going to need a clean energy production miracle through a massive green stimulus. Transformation in every sector. We're talking about agricultural overhaul to localize agriculture as much as possible to make it carbon neutral. It's going to be a lot more organic, and permaculture techniques. We're going to need land use overhaul, electrify the transportation system, huge research and development efforts and adaptation. Direct regulation of industry. It is not written anywhere that we need to solve climate change through market forces. And frankly, it's not gonna work. There is a common misunderstanding that if we, I'm preaching to the choir here at the Left Forum, but this idea that if we reduce government power, that it makes people more free. In fact, it empowers corporations, and we as the voting public lose our power over our collective destiny. We want a strong federal government that regulates industry to protect us all. Ban all investment in new fossil fuel uses and infrastructure, quickly phase out the fossil fuel sector, and mandatory conservation and efficiency rules. The Pledge to Mobilize is our platform. We elaborate what the climate mobilization would be to try and provide as good an example as we can about what this would look like to help people understand it. However, the Pledge to Mobilize is a one-page document that does not prescribe specific policy solutions. So we think the best way to deal with fossil fuel infrastructure is to set a timetable to shut it down. However, that is not in the pledge. Whatever mechanism, so this is about electing a government that is committed to getting the United States to carbon zero by 2025 in a World War II scale mobilization. The specific policies that they choose to achieve that goal, we're open to it, as long as it's within the bounds of the Constitution. But the point is rapid decarbonization in every sector. And we will achieve full employment, where it's gonna cause rapid change in every sector, but Americans need protection from this level of economic disruption. So everyone who wants a job in the climate mobilization will be able to have one. This happened during World War II. Pearl Harbor snapped the country out of denial. And this is exactly the level of collective awakening that we need to achieve on climate change. People walk around as though we weren't in danger. And we need to realize that we are in the fight for our lives, for our civilization, for our species, and every other species. And when you get that level of collective and individual realization, things change very, very quickly. And it's already happening. The People's Climate March, where we launched in September 21st, 2014, brought over 100,000 people to the streets, but without a specific policy program or demand, right? Everyone wants action on climate change, but there's not a ton of unification within the movement on how to go about that. So the Pledge to Mobilize solves a lot of these problems. Our job is to fight denial and passivity by spreading climate truth and the Pledge to Mobilize, to use the pledge to build political power, and to take advantage of the 2016 elections, particularly the primaries. You know, we have these long drawn out primaries in the United States that capture tons of political coverage. We want to be at campaign events asking every candidate, will you protect civilization or not? Do you have the courage, do you have the strength of character to realize that we are in this crisis and to lead us out of it? And as a movement, as a strategy, everyone contributes what they can from getting from here to climate mobilization. As Grover Norquist demonstrated with his taxpayer protection pledge, that with enough pressure, political pledges work. Grover Norquist was really able to hijack the agenda of the Republican Party through this pledge. It wielded enormous political power, and that's what we're out to do. We are now in the phase of public actions. Our most organized local community is San Diego, led by a very devoted and bold couple in their 70s who put together in March 15th our first public rally for mobilization, attended by 375 people. The pledge to mobilize gives people a route to engagement that says, share your climate story with others, meaning none of us were born knowing about the climate crisis. We all came to this somehow. How did it happen? How did you become climate alarmed? And talk about what's happening in the climate, and that talk about climate change as an emergency that requires an urgent, large-scale response. Take the pledge to mobilize and spread it to the public as well as friends and family. This is an on-ramp to engagement. On our website, theclimatemobilization.org, we have printable materials as well as action guides to give a public presentation, like using these slides that I'm using. These are for everyone to use. On the climate crisis, offer the pledge to mobilize at public events, organize a rally, put direct pressure on political candidates or elected officials, you know, mobilize your online presence. On all of my emails that go out, it says, the climate change is an emergency. Let's treat it like one. Let's mobilize. And use all of your skills and resources to help bring us closer to mobilization. This is Fred Bramfman. He was a lifelong activist and instrumental in exposing the US bombing of Laos during the Vietnam War. He was with us at the very beginning, or actually before our launch, and he would have been one of our founding members, but he died before he was able to. But he talked about climate change as our sublime opportunity to be able to give ourselves fully to a cause, to our human brothers and sisters and future generations. I mean, obviously climate change is a tremendous threat, but it is also an opportunity for us as individuals to do something truly heroic. And the climate mobilization asks for heroic engagement from citizens and our elected leaders.